Hello everyone, my name is Caetano Miranda, the Director of Education and Diffusion of Knowledge of the Research Center for Greenhouse Gas Innovation, one of the leading engineering research centers of FAPESP. Today on our RCGI Colloquia series, you're going to have the Dr. Renato Picelli. He's one of the youngest and most promising professors from the Polytechnic School in the University of São Paulo. So this colloquia series are organized as a series of public lectures prepared for the broad audience by leading authorities on the subject and also promising young researchers with fresh and innovative scientific and technological ideas across research programs on the RCGIs, the nature-based solutions, carbon capture and utilization, bioenergy, carbon capture and storage, greenhouse gas, and advocacy. So we also are very grateful to the sponsors, FAPESP and Shell, and the technical support by Ana Paula Vasconcelos from our communication team. So followed by this introduction in the lecture, you're going to have a questions and answers session, and they're stimulated to you to bring your questions, comments along with the presentation within the chat, either in the YouTube, Facebook, and any other channels that you may ask for us. So let me then introduce our speaker. So Professor Picelli has a PhD in mechanical engineering from the State University of Campinas, Unicamp, with experiences in the Cardiff School of Engineering, Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands, the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology in Australia, and also in the University of California, San Diego. So nowadays, Professor Picelli holds a FAPESP Young Investigator Award at the Polytechnic School in the University of São Paulo, with broad range of works on the multiphysics and multiscale problems, ranging from acoustic fluid structure interaction, stress analysis, and material design, using the so-called topological optimization. So today, you're going to tell us about this exciting technique that arranges several projects at RCGIs with his talk entitled Topology Optimization by Sequential Integer Linear Programming Applied to Multiphysics Problems. So with this, Professor Picelli, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and the floor is yours.
It's my pleasure and my privilege to be here at RCGI. Thank you, Professor Caetano Miranda. Thank you, everyone, for listening to me and attending this talk. Yes, indeed. My name is Renato Picelli. I'm currently a research fellow under the Young Investigators Awards by FAPESP. I'm very proud to work for the Polytechnic School of the University of São Paulo and also to work for the Research Center for Greenhouse Gas Innovation. As Caetano said, my background is in mechanical engineering, and my research topic mainly focuses on design optimization of multiphysics problems. And thinking about that, the talk today is a broader talk and for a broader audience. I chose to start a story, to tell you a story on what fascinates me as an engineer. So actually, I started to think about, to prepare these slides, I started to ask that myself, and I encourage you to question you as well, because I find that sometimes I find a hard time to answer this properly to myself. But what fascinates me is the way we sail, the way we capture energy from nature and generate electricity, the way we deal with noise and construct large-scale civil structures or explore the sea, the ocean. But as important as that, I think the question is, what motivates me to be an engineer? What motivates me to be here fighting for a place or working for a place between so many good engineers, physicists, chemists? So what drives me to do the work and research and teaching is how we make these things happen, how we can make a ship to sail, how we actually can make a structure to generate electricity or how we can actually explore the ocean. But more than that is how we design these things, how we make these things by designing them, how we design a ship, how we design a wind turbine, how we design a house for mitigating noise, etc., how we design subsea systems, but not only design, but design better. I think we are in a constant mission to design better with less. And that's my, I think that's one of our, we should have this motto, why we should design better with less, or are, have we been designing better with less? Because our resources are limited and our demands are growing. And actually, we actually are paying for, we are paying a high price to learn this lesson. I think societal and economical thriving cannot be achieved without sustainable development. So we need, this should be a motto. Sustainable design should be, or sustainable development as well, should be in our mission, in our daily profession activities. And how can we be part of this constant mission is by designing optimization is one of the tools that we can use for that. I think, of course, we have some good intuition from our professionals. We have built upon years of knowledge. We have experience, but design optimization is a tool that can push us even further. And the talk today is centered around design optimization of multiphysics problems. And to start that, I actually invite you to go back into the classroom with me, and we will carry out a experiment number one here, which I call natural frequency manipulation. So the challenge is, think about this bi-clamped beam here. I invite you to think about how to design this actual, this bi-clamped structure here with 50% of volume. And you can place material, solid material, wherever you want here within these bounds here, this height and this width. This structure is under free vibration. Let's assume this hypothesis here. And what can you do to design a better structure in order to manipulate natural frequencies or fundamental frequencies? Free vibration is a very important engineering problem. So that's an important activity then. So, but before, actually, let's investigate the behavior of this structure. Actually, I chose here to design a structure within this dashed line, the blue dashed line, with 50% of volume, as I said here. And so with these dimensions and property, I went there to my favorite finite element software, and I computed the eigenmodes and eigenfrequencies of this structure. These are very nice plots from the software. These are the eigenmodes, the first, second, third. These are the values I got for the first three natural frequencies of these structure that I designed. I designed a simple structure here, but let's move on. Let's move on with this experiment. Actually, the challenge here, the experiment goes further and tells you, we actually should design a structure within this bi-clamped beam configuration that is placed under a water tank or under a mass of water. This could be a system in the Itaipu Dam or in Iguaçu Falls in Paraná State, or a general water tank on the ground. Okay, so we choose our engineering model here. We're modeling this system. We have then an added mass of water here. We have an open surface with a reference pressure. We have rigid walls and the lateral walls, and we still have here our bi-clamped structure. We now have actually a new governing equation that describes the free vibration of the fluid part. The fluid is considered to be at rest, so there is no actually fluid flow here. In this case, the fluid is at rest, inviscid, and irrotational. And there are, of course, some coupling conditions because we have two physics here, the acoustic fluid, actually, and the structure, linear structure. And that's a typical case of an acoustic structure interaction problem. And then again, I went there into my favorite FEA software. I compared here, these are the plots for the eigenmodes and eigenfrequencies for the system without water column. And with the water column, we observe here that our eigenfrequencies, our natural frequencies are decreased in a certain amount, a considerable value. The first and second modes are still the same or very similar at least. But the third mode is different, quite different, because we have now a different coupled physics problem. And then our design actually might change. Or the challenge here, the structural design problem here, is much more challenging in this case. Yeah, but going back to the design challenge, I still have here a structural design problem. I propose this design problem here. The water tank now has an open edge here. So we can have two configurations, actually. An open cavity with this, if you open the lid here of the tank, but also the closed cavity if you close here the tank. So there are two different boundary conditions. The open cavity has a reference pressure, and the closed cavity would be a rigid wall as well. Again, so how would we design a structure in order to manipulate the eigenfrequencies of these or the natural frequencies of this system? We are still not designing yet, but we are investigating the problem, the physics, the multiphysics problem. So there are two configurations, as I said. I plotted there as well in the FAA software. The first row shows the eigenmodes of the open cavity system. And if we close the water tank, we get a different set of eigenmodes. Actually, what happened is that the first mode of the open cavity vanishes. It doesn't happen anymore, and you have the other set. But if you want to maximize the first natural frequency of this system, we see that we have two different configurations and two different design problems if you want to maximize the natural frequency and keep this fundamental frequency far from an operation frequency of this system. Okay, so the design problem is I want to do a structural design via a design optimization technique. I want to maximize the first natural frequency of this entire system here by only changing the way I choose solid material to be constructed this structure here, using 50% of volume fraction of this entire design domain. As I showed you before, I started with initial gas design, actually, right? I started with 50%, a simple design. Okay, we will start with that. And that's applying a design optimization method here. These are the solutions I got. The design for open cavity was this one. We can see here a curved structure with a hole in it, thick parts at the lateral walls. And because we have a different configuration of the eigenmode and eigenfrequencies for the closed cavity, the design optimization technique I used designed a totally different structure at the bottom of the water tank with two curved shapes in the center of the structure with two big holes here as well. But as you see, for the initial gas design, let's say for the open cavity, the natural frequency was 73 hertz, something like that. And we maximized, we used the design optimization method here. I'm not into details now, I will give you details later. And we actually designed a structure or a water tank bottom with 120 hertz. And that could be helpful to keep the resonance effect lower in this case. Let's say if you have an operating system of 70 hertz here, you are keeping your natural frequency far from it. And a similar thing from 260 to 420, that's what we did for the closed cavity. And let's examine how the design optimization case went for the closed cavity configuration. And then please pay attention again that it will repeat. You see that we started with a simple straight structure here, straight design, and it went to, we maximized the first natural frequency, and we got that solution. And then you tell me, okay, Renato, but that's a nonsense solution. How would I build that, or why would I build that? But that's not actually what I think it should be our approach. I think our approach should be, is it actually a crazy or a nonsense solution? I don't think it is. I think we can start from this and maybe do a post-processing or get inspired by this design and propose an actual design for us to build. We can design optimization can thus give us a better starting point. Okay, so my talk actually starts now, actually. I prepared a 40, 45, 50 minutes talk with the introduction. I'll give you two more experiments. I'll talk about topology optimization. So the center of this talk, the theme of this talk is topology optimization, and you will hear this word a lot now, and give you several applications. So topology optimization actually started as a computational method for structural optimization or structural design optimization. There are three types that you can consider in structural optimization. Is the first one, if you are only concerned about the parameters of your predefined structure, if you have a truss-like structure here and you only optimize for the cross-section of each truss, you do parametric optimization. But then if you have some holes in it and you want to optimize only the shape of the holes, only the curves, then you model them and you move them and then you do shape optimization. You keep the same configuration as in the beginning, but with different shapes. And topology optimization, which is the most flexible type of the structural optimization, that you don't need actually a priori to know any of your design. You can start from a full solid design or an initial guess design, as we did in the experiment one. And then you apply topology optimization. Topology optimization gives you the amount of holes, the connection of the structures, the shapes of them. So it gives you a nice starting point. So the secret here in the structural design, the art of the structure is where to put the holes. That's what our friend here said back in the days. So that's what topology optimization is doing. And topology optimization is nothing else than solving a mathematical optimization problem where you want to minimize an objective function, subject to constraint functions. And you need an indicator, what we call design variable. Design variable here should be usually a 0-1 configuration, 1 meaning solid and 0 meaning void. So if you have a structural design domain here and you apply topology optimization will give you a design based on these design variables by solving this mathematical programming problem. And it will give you an organic-like shape design with the holes and topology, and etc. We'll give you, with the indicator, we'll give you where to build or not the structure. This is the classic example of topology optimization, which is to find the stiffest structure subject to a volume fraction constraint. Usually, we employ the finite element method to compute the properties, the displacements, and the behavior of the structure. For each finite element, we actually assign our design variable that can also be called pseudo-density. So we interpolate the property of interest. As we want to design a stiff structure, we are interpolating stiffness here using a penalty model. So our finite element matrix actually has the interpolation or the design variable included. So your optimizer can tune up your design variable in order to give you this topology. And depending on the way you interpolate, you have different material models. This is called, the way you interpolate is a material law or a material model. This is the standard algorithm that you can use. You can employ topology optimization. So you want to minimize half of the force applied force times the structural displacement. This function is the mean structural compliance. Minimizing the structural compliance is equivalent to maximize stiffness. So you usually minimize compliance subject to a volume fraction and a design variable, a binary design variable here. This is the standard problem. I mean, not design variables might change a lot, actually. I'll give you more details about that. But you define the problem, define domain and mesh. You carry out FEA. You see here the material models inside the FEA now. We usually employ a gradient-based algorithm to solve this problem. So we need to compute sensitivities. We need the gradient information of all of our functions here. Of course, this problem might change every time, so we have to compute sensitivities. We filter them to smooth things out and stabilize the problem. And our optimizer gives a solution and every time. So you actually iterate every time here to get a design. Okay, so in this pixelated approach, there are main two types of design variables. Yeah, the first one is a standard approach called density-based method, where the design variables can assume values, continuous values between 0 and 1, and you see here it's plotted in a gray scale, gray meaning an intermediate value between 0 and 1. This is actually the most popular method, the most spread method in literature and also in the FEA software. But our group's approach here we employ binary design variables. We actually keep things to be binary. We want to we want our design variable to be either 0 or 1, and because of that, you have explicit control where you have your solid material and where you have your void. There's no grayscale in that. So if you have explicit control, you can combine these regions with other physics. You can include other physics in the problem, like the first experiment we did. And why topology optimization? Topology optimization, then you might already be thinking about it. It's a powerful tool for conceptual design. It's a powerful tool for your, as I said already, your first design, your conceptual design, your geometrical design. So look into this example. We have here actually a belt system in the car. This system was built with 8 pieces and assembled all together. But let's actually redesign and start from zero. We actually employ topology optimization, or also you might have been heard about generative design. It's a similar idea. And this piece here, this part, is 40% lighter, 20% stiffer, and built only with one piece. And then you say again, oh, but that's a nonsense solution again. But there's a perfect match nowadays that you can print this structure. You can have you can employ additive manufacturing, and then get a nicer solution, a lighter and a stiffer solution, and save also material from the nature that you're using. But as beautiful as that, actually, one of the beauty of the methods that I find mostly interesting is that topology optimization teaches us things. And topology optimization is useful for studying some physics. And why? Actually, I bring to you the experiment number 2. Okay, so let's talk about submerged structures now. Examples. We have this remote operated vehicle here under the sea, and this floating tunnel built with concrete. These two structures, they have a hydrostatic pressure loading all over them. Okay, so it's a challenging type of loading. Let's apply topology optimization to design a structure for this engineering model here that I separated for you. We have here, we want to maximize stiffness or minimize compliance. We want to design a structure with 15% of this volume of this rectangle. There are clamped support conditions here, and the hydrostatic pressure loading here is represented with the blue domain and red arrows. We have here the hydrostatic loading. You apply topology optimization, you see how it evolves. As I told you, if you have explicit control where you have solid and void, you can keep track of your pressure loading. And because you're changing your design here and you are under the water, your pressure load actually changes. It depends on your design, okay? And why? Why did I bring that? Topology optimization solutions tend to show us optimized design direction. So it teaches us where is the optimized direction. But in the case of hydrostatic loading, curved structures tend to perform better. And that's what topology optimization is telling us. Okay, for some students, that might not be obvious, but for some of you, that might be obvious. But that's what I find beautiful from topology optimization. It teaches us things. But considering this is okay, this is not that hard example, let's go to a more complex example. So experiment number 3, this is the last experiment of the talk. Let's design a buoyance module. Buoyance modules are buoys that are used in manufacturing for subsea applications, let's say. They look like that, the commercial ones. You can they provide buoyancy forces or fluctuation forces for oil pipelines. They help in reducing compression in subsea pipelines, so they help to reduce buckling, and they keep pipelines configurations in certain desirable configurations. Okay, so the same case, we have a submerged structure here. We have a buoyant structure. There's pressure loading all over it. It's hydrostatic, constant pressure. We want to design a structure within this gray domain here. We want to maximize the stiffness. The inner part here, the inner ring, should not be optimized because we need to assemble the system here. But we want to design a different configuration of this buoyance module. We want to reduce volume. We have a constraint on volume, so we want to use less solid material. And we want to prescribe some buoyancy forces. So Think with me, the stiffest structure for this buoyant structure would be, the stiffest structure under the sea would be a structure without any holes. And by imposing this constraint, we are saying that we are prescribing at least a minimum amount or a minimum quantity of volume, including interior voids. So we include a buoyancy constraint, that is the volume of the solid material plus interior voids. As you see here, this constraint of the buoyancy constraint is represented by the red line here. The blue line here, blue dots, represent the actual volume of solid plus voids. And they have to be, this volume has to be above this red constraint here. You see in the beginning, look again, you see in the beginning, it's maximizing stiffness. So maximizing stiffness means there's no need for holes. But when your constraint is violated, inner holes are being constructed. And then until convergence, you see here. Okay, so without knowing that, I was designing something that looked like bubbles. If you bear with me here, you see the inner parts of the structure that we designed. This is the optimal solution we got, the optimized solution we got. The inner parts of the structures are straight members, just like in bubbles. And the outer parts of it are curved shapes, just like in bubbles as well. So bubbles are in equilibrium and possibly in the minimal state of energy. And actually, so by solving that problem with topology optimization, I just encountered that a good buoy would be a bubble. And that's what I think that's nice. You can question the topology solution, but you cannot question nature. So that's nice. Okay, so moving on to giving you a recipe for doing topology optimization. This is specifically the case that I developed in my before my fellowship, my research fellowship. Let's solve. We published this paper in 2018. We call this method topology optimization of binary structures, or TOBS, or TOPS. We want to minimize in the constraint function, objective functions, subjective constraint functions, and we want to keep design variables to be binary. We start the problem by expanding all these functions into Taylor series and truncating them at the linear part. So there it is. So we actually want to solve the linearized optimization problem sequentially. Notice that we had design variable X, but we actually want to design a structure. We want to solve this problem because we linearized the problem, we are solving for delta X for the change in the original binary design variable. We need to impose some move limits. Let's say you start with 100% volume and you want to decrease to 60%. A 40% volume is a too big of a jump for the optimization. You have to go slowly. So we relax the constraint at every iteration by making the target value to be small with a arbitrary epsilon value here. We slowly move our constraint function GI towards the G bar prescribed values. And we need also to improve another move limit here, that is the truncation error constraint. We want to restrict the amount of changes in the design variables X. So the delta X should be the amount of the summation of the delta X should be small. So you should restrict drastic design changes between one iteration to another in order to converge. And the original binary constraint is rewritten in this form. If you have a void element here, your delta X can either be zero, do nothing, or add one, so it becomes a solid. So if you have a solid before, you can either do nothing, or your delta X can be minus one as well, so remove that element from there. And then translating this, we can rewrite the constraint into this thing, to this form. And with efficient implementation by commercial or open source libraries and computational power, we are now available to include branch and bound solver and integer programming solvers into topology optimization. The last decade, there was a consensus that was not possible, but now that is. So this is the standard form that TOBS method solves the problem. These are all known ingredients in the optimization community. But the recipe is what makes it work. If you find yourself to more curious and want to learn more about it, you can just go to TOBS 101. Actually, you can download a supplementary material there in this paper from that journal website. I have written an educational code with tutorials for you to learn more about it. But of course, you can just write to me, or we can interact, and I'm glad to tell you to answer your questions here or later on. Okay, but just a quick example. So the continuous variables method, the density-based method, might offer you a grayscale design. Let's look into this design problem. We have here again a bi-clamped structure. We have a point load, mechanical load here, and we have a sudden change in the overall temperature of this structure. So we have a thermal expansion load, a delta T, okay? Actually, the best design, or close to optimal design, would be actually a grayscale configuration. But most of times, it's very hard to build that. It's not, there's no physical sense to have an intermediate plate, let's say, and intermediate density metal. But then you want to keep things binary. If you use TOBS, we cut the problem from the root of the optimization, and it never allows you to have to obtain a grayscale design. Okay, yeah, so approached the half of our talk today, and I'll give you several applications using TOBS and actually other methods as well. So here, I'll throw to you a bunch of physical applications. We keep the thermal expansion problem, but now we are trying to design here a structure that is under the sea. We're extracting oil, so there's pressure loading of the water column here all over the structure. There's delta T again, there's a thermal expansion. I'm solving this benchmark problem for pressure loading in topology optimization. I'm using Laplace's equation as a constant pressure to compute a constant pressure here. There are rollers and a bi-clamped support here. The challenge for topology optimization in this case is to deal with design-dependent loading, as I showed you for the arch-like structure. If you change your design and your structure is under the sea or there's a pressure load, you have to keep track of the fluid structure interfaces. And also, the thermal expansion loads, they depend on the volume your structure, your solid material occupies. So it's another design dependent load, but it's a design dependent body load. This is the reference case without delta T, so delta T is equals to zero. If we apply a positive thermal expansion load here, we see that the inner bars, they disappear, okay? And if the 1, 3, and 5, and if you apply a negative thermal expansion load here, you see that the entire configuration of your topology, of your structure, changes, the curvature, etc. And that's because thermal expansion changes the way your structure is deformed, either in compression or tension, depending on the region. Another example, again, our ROV, here's our ROV system here. Structures under the sea are under compression loads, and compression leads to buckling. And buckling, we want to solve a problem here, including a buckling constraint. So we want to minimize compliance. So we want to design a stiff structure, subject to the equilibrium equation, volume fraction. And now we want to make sure that the critical buckling load, lambda one, is larger or equal than a prescribed lambda bar here, okay? So we actually solved the same piston head problem, but notice that we actually used a roller in here for these results. The reference result without a buckling load or without a buckling constraint here has a lambda one, a critical buckling load of 0.38. But when you increase the constraint, when you force lambda one to satisfy the constraint here, you see that total topology, the overall topology changes, and you observe the creation of holes in the lateral members here. But that's because the structure is tilting because of this roller. In the paper we published, you can see other boundary conditions effect. And extending this method to a fluid structure interaction problem. So let's just rethink about topology optimization. This is another way of doing topology optimization. We want to propose a new surface capturing method or a boundary integrated method. For that, we are proposing to separate optimization and analysis meshes. I told you that actually your design variables in the standard form of topology optimization, your design variables are related to each finite element that you use to simulate the structure. Here, let's forget about that. We have a 0-1 solution. We had our TOBS solver. We extract the contour of the structure, and we create a CAD. Okay, we create a CAD. We actually smooth the walls as well. And this CAD, we actually trim the CAD. We throw out the void areas. And that's what we are calling TOBS with geometry trimming. So this method, this overall idea is called TOBS GT. With that, we can generate a conveniently coarse mesh or a physics-based mesh. So we can model boundary layers. Let's say if you're simulating a fluid flow here. So you can pay attention to these things. You solve your physics here, you do your sensitivities, and you go back by interpolating your information to your TOBS, okay? The TOBS solver. So one possible advantage is that, for instance, we are going to solve now a fluid structure interaction problem with the turbulent flow. So we actually need to properly model what happens at the interface. And if your finite element mesh was a fixed grid, that would be very weird for computing turbulence, let's say. Okay, so we want to minimize compliance subject to a volume fraction of 10% in this model here. We have a fluid structure interaction problem now. I'm still assuming small displacements, okay, but a fluid flow with high speed. We want to design the structure within this gray area. There's a fluid flowing from the left edge to the right edge here. There's a non-designable wall here in black. This is the solution we got. So the fluid is flowing from the left to the right. This is the solution we got, the CAD geometry, velocity field, pressure field. So one important thing here in this idea is that we are separating the finite element mesh and the optimization grids, as I said. So to simulate this entire physics, we used around 16,000 elements between triangles and quads. So we could model boundary layers properly either here or inside the design domain. But the optimization mesh was kept into a high resolution, like 45%. So because they are detached, we can solve the physics with a relatively cheaper mesh than we would need if it was a fixed grid approach. Okay, another example now. We are working here. I'm working here together with in a project together with Professor Emilio Silva. This is one application in the project. We want to solve the FSI problem and include natural frequency constraints. Why? Because we want to get rid to avoid resonance in the fluid structure interaction problem. We want to design the inner part of this elastic wall here, okay? But let's assume that, let's say we have a transient problem here. You have a vortex generation. You can compute your vortex shedding frequency here, your dominant peak. We tuned up the natural frequency of this elastic wall to be coincident or quite close to the vortex shedding frequency. So we observed a lot of oscillations here, a lot of vibration. But then solving an optimization problem with a transient analysis is quite expensive because topology optimization is an iterative process. So you need a lot of computations. Okay, so instead of doing a transient analysis, we solved the optimization problem with a steady state fluid flow FSI problem here. We want to solve the minimum compliance problem subject to a volume, to a natural frequency constraint or larger than 3 hertz. So the first natural frequency constraint, the fundamental frequency, should be larger or equal than 3. We observed here that the optimization went on. There's no volume constraint here. So the optimizer, even though wanted to curve the structure, so in order to push the natural frequency to 3 hertz. And then when we solve the transient problem again, like a post-processing, we see that the resonance effect was much lower here, and the oscillations were much lower as well. So before the optimization, the stiffest structure would be a full solid design with a lot of oscillations. And after the optimization, a less stiff structure would present less resonance. Okay, going on, still, let's say a stress-based design, we are only talking about compliance at the moment, right? If you solve a stiff structure for this L bracket example here, you would obtain such an example of this. But look into the inner part here, the re-entered corner, you have a high stress concentration, so your topologies, your structure would fail. So we can as well include a stress measure in the optimization. The problem is that stress is a localized quantity, so you have to control all your stresses, the stresses all over your structure. But there is a function that you can aggregate all these stresses into one single function called p-norm. If you want actually to minimize the p-norm stress that actually approximate the maximum stress of your structure, you don't get a structure that has a stress concentration here, and then you move on. Still about stress, we want to minimize stress under within a region of interest. So we have this plate here. We want to minimize stress only in this square dashed line, with the dashed line here. We started with this configuration. There's a high stress in that region. If you minimize stress there, let's say you start with that solution with six holes, and then the optimization goes on, you obtain an optimized design that actually isolates the stress within that region of interest. So you started with a high stress here, and you do optimization, and then you have much lower stress within this. A good application would be that if that region cannot have stresses at all, like if you have a sensor that is sensitive to stress, you can use this methodology. Other application is on energy harvesting. Let's assume that we have a piezoelectric system here. We have a plate here, an elastic plate. We want to minimize nothing. I don't want to minimize anything here. I just want to push the natural frequency of this system to be within a range of interest that it will be the operating range of frequencies in this case, because in this case, I want the structure to vibrate. So the first initial solution, which is this design, we have these larger natural frequencies, the three ones. The first one was already within the interest of range of interest, that is between 100 and 500. And after applying optimization, we pushed down the three natural frequencies to be within 100 and 500 hertz. So if you apply that, this structure in your aircraft, let's say, that is operating around these values, assume you will harvest more energy with your piezoelectric thing. Okay, so moving on to fluids. Let's forget about up to the moment we were simulating fluids, but we were interested in designing the structure. Now we want to design the fluid flow path or the fluid flow itself. Let's look into this pipe band design. We have an inlet here, an outlet here. We are simulating the fluid flow now with the Rankine equations using the turbulence model. We want to minimize the turbulent flow energy in order to design a fluid flow that loses less energy within its way. So we started with a fluid design. This is, you see a lot of recirculations here. The optimization goes on. Design, in the end, a very nice pipe band that presents less dissipation. Okay. So this is actually also TOBSGT idea. We have a staircase optimization grid, which is not good for turbulence, but we don't use that. We actually solve the optimization here, but we post-process it during optimization. We generate a smooth CAD. We properly model turbulence with this mesh, and then you do until your convergence. Now we want to do the opposite. Instead of minimizing the fluid energy, we want to maximize the fluid energy dissipation. So we want to design a fluid diode. We want to reduce the emission of, let's say, GHE, greenhouse gases from pneumatic machines, let's say. So we want to design a labyrinth of a fluid flow that will try to hold or to seal pneumatic machines in this way in order to avoid gas leakage, let's say. So we are experimenting with two objectives in this case, fluid flow dissipation, but we want to maximize it now. A trivial solution would be just close the outlet, but you cannot do that, otherwise your machine will explode. But so you want to seal this stator and rotor in this case. So you want to impose a minimum gap here, so to solve the maximization of fluid flow dissipation. And the other one is the diodicity, also which is present in the Tesla valve design. I'm not presenting details of this Tesla valve design, but the group here from Professor Emilio should publish one paper soon. This is a Emilio student. And the Tesla valve is a passive valve that allows the fluid to flow nicely from one direction to the other, like here from the left to the right, but enforces the fluid to go through tiny or different paths, so in order to lose energy in the backwards flow. So it doesn't tend to go back, just go to one direction. Okay, but in order to maximize the energy dissipation, we want to design the labyrinth here. As I said, we are assuming a 2D swirl flow. So you have your shaft rotating here. We have to model that. So we want to maximize energy dissipation and subject to a minimum gap construct. We want to design from the inlet here, we want to design the labyrinth here, and the outlet is here. Because I told you we have explicit control what each variable is, we can apply this minimum gap constraint for each element here, for each optimization point here. We can say, you can become a rotor in this case is red, or you can become a stator, which is black here, or either you cannot become anything because you're approaching the other structure. And in white here, you see that's the fluid flow path. This is an illustration just to show you that the minimum gap is satisfied. This is a 2D swirl problem, so there's an axis symmetry here. This is a revolved plot, and that's it. This is the final solution, where we have here the labyrinth design. There's recirculation zones. Local dissipation is plotted here, and we are using pressure drop, delta P, to quantify how much leakage we can avoid comparing to commercial design. The last physics I will show you is acoustics. So applying the idea of TOBS-GT for acoustics. So we are assuming the wave equation now. We want to minimize sound pressure level in a region of interest. So we have here, this is a 2D room, an enclosed 2D room with reflecting walls. There is a machine here, or there's a noise being generated here. There's an excitation here, acoustic excitation. We want to minimize the sound pressure level in this domain probe here, OP, by designing the roof, by putting solid or rigid elements in the roof. And that's how it goes, the optimization. You see that the design here, this is the final design. So the roof is changed here. So with that, we started, if you didn't have any rigid element here or region, you had a sound pressure level above 100 decibels, while after optimization your sound pressure level was below 80. Okay, so we have a group here. I'm very also very glad to interact with the local group from our CGI, coordinated by Professor Emilio Silva. As I said, they are working with compressible flow, so there are tons of applications we could do here. If anyone is interested, thermal fluids, that would be very nice to design heat exchangers. There is also another collaboration here, RCGI, on fuel cells. We can also work on acoustics, air acoustics, mitigation of noise. This is something I'm very interested in. Civil structures like self-weight, or in aerospace structure like inertial driven load. And harmonic loads as well, energy harvesting, as I said, and metamaterials. Okay. And that's very much a privilege to be here, to be talking to you. I hope that you had a nice time, and I'm glad to answer questions. Thank you very much, every one of you.
Thank you so much, Picelli, for this very exciting, insightful experiments that on topology optimization that you showed to us. If someone has some questions, please, you can bring it to the chat. But then let me start it, since I'm very fan of this technique. And I would like to hear from you. First of all, can you comment on the limitations of the technique in terms of computational cost, and also what you needed in order to to apply the topology optimization?
Well, the bottleneck of the optimization is solving the physics. So every tool that we developed, the community developed, not just us, sensitivity filtering, optimizers, they are all cheap compared to solving physics. And because we are trying to solve now even more complex problems, every time from year to year, we're trying to solve complex problems, the tendency is that solving the physics will be just the focus on how to solve a design optimization case. That's what
I'm saying. And you bring at some point this relationship between the topology optimization with the additive manufacturer. Could you tell us a little bit more about it?
Yes, so usually topology optimization leads you to organic shapes, also organic-like structures, and that's indeed somehow could be hard to be manufactured, but we have this perfect match with additive manufacturing, and as an additive manufacturing is a whole other universe of research. People are developing additive manufacturing. We should soon, we already have, but we should even year to year, we should have better technology for printing these structures. So in the future, in the near future, to my opinion, we will be able to work together more and more closely in order to design disruptive structures, disruptive systems, fluid flow systems, and so on.
Mm-hmm. In the so you bring in some of your contributions on the binary structures, the Taubes methodology. So can you go beyond that? I mean, what do you see as a feature in terms of a methodology implementations that could be done in order to make it more efficient? Or
yes, I think actually the one nice thing that we could solve is this binary thing. So we made a jump on solving problems that grayscale had problems before. It's not that grayscale is bad, but grayscale is the most popular method, and it's a very good method. In my view, I think what the future brings us is a hybrid method that we have all of these tools, binary, grayscale, we have a boundary capturing method. I think these are all tools that we can make benefit to any specific case in the future. So there won't be just one answer, but there will be a range of tools and possibly a hybrid method that the one I said, TOBSGT, is some sort of hybrid method because we are still trying to have an ice wall while having a binary representation of it. So I think.
Picelli, we have a question from Professor Giulio Meneghini. So his question is, in your opinion, which are the main challenges in the topology optimization, in which are the most challenging areas to apply it?
In my view, I think we should work to solve multiple constraint problems, like stress constraint problems, because topology optimization started with a linear volume constraint. And that's somehow very easy. Now we can say that it's very easy to solve. But actually, engineer problems involve mechanical stress, involve displacement constraints. It's much more than just designing a stiff structure. So that, in my opinion, the challenges are to solve optimization problems with multiple constraints. And we should work on that, especially nonlinear constraints. And the areas, the most challenging areas for me, it's multiphysics problems. That's why I like to work with multiphysics. Fluid flow is very challenging. I think nobody's doing noise mitigation combined with CFD. So there are tons of areas that we could work on.
And which strategies usually is used in order to handle the different physics phenomena that is happening simultaneously? So if I wanna, you bring some examples during your talk that is.
I think, you have to study each physics in a single optimization, a single physics optimization case first. That's what I would do. So we know how to push natural frequencies towards a constraint, but we didn't know before. Okay, so that's now we know. And we didn't know how to solve a fluid structure interaction problem. Now we know. So now we can combine these two different governing equations or these two different constraints into a single problem. So I think the strategy is that to tackle the problem from different parts of it. And then because solving a topology optimization problem is you have to formulate your topology optimization problem. And each formulation reserves to you its own characteristics and its own challenges.
Could share with us some examples where solutions coming from the topology optimization has been already bring it to the industry, for instance, or to some device that people
I think an aircraft, because you need to have a stiff air, stiff structure and a lightweight structure. So I think aircraft is already using topology optimization in their design. Automotive design as well. You need to save fuel. So if you need a lightweight structure, if you have a lighter car, you will need less fuel to push the car and so on.
We have a question from Professor Marcos Bucaridi. So what are your thoughts about possible bio-inspired topology optimization strategies?
Yeah, that's a good question, because actually one of the binary...
Nature, yeah, you are imitating nature or...
I think, yeah, we are trying to... If we can compare with nature design, that would be fantastic. That's why actually... That was a discussion I had with Emilio, and that's why I brought the buoyancy module design, because if I could design a structure that I wasn't thinking about it, then I realized that actually looked like a bubble. And it gave me the confidence to say, okay, I'm in the right direction. So if nature did that, I think, my design is okay. And we can have tons of inspirations. We can maybe try to look for topology optimization problems that actually generate what nature does. One example is, in the future, it would be nice to understand the root of a tree, the functions of a tree, if there is a structural function or not, and if that depends on the height of the tree, if there's a buckling involved in the tree, and so on.
Because I remember one of the challenges on this field is actually the scale. No, it's not something that you can bring as a nature solution for. Scale is the different... size and structures that may have it,
but in terms of large scale problems, I think we also need to work on that to actually solve practical problems, also maybe look into multi-scale designs as well.
And just for curiosity, you bring in the your last slide several topics, from those, what do you think that will be the one that gives may provide a more impact in terms of on the course of the RCGI? And together with that, Professor Thiago Lopes also asked about, how would be able to write your own topology optimization softwares, or the softwares available for the community?
Okay. So to my opinion, we should... to make impact, and together with RCGI, we can work on energy problems, like fluid flow problems are all present in energy problems, fuel cells, heat exchangers. So all of these problems, in my mind, they will help us with the energy transition. So if we focus on that, we are aligned with the RCGI, and we are aligned with our society needs at the moment. And to answer Thiago, yes, we could have an in-house code, actually. We could centralize that, actually, and bring students to put all the methods together. As I said, all the methods are tools that can benefit us in a certain way. And if we can have our own in-house code, that would be great. And we could do that.
Well, is that it, Picelli? Thank you so much for this very inspiring talk. Certainly, people are going to be even more interested in the topology optimization. And with that, I invite you, our attendees, for our next RCGI colloquia in 2 weeks. Thank you so much, and have a
thank you all.
Nice day. Yeah.